श्री साईनाथाय नमः। श्री समर्थ सद्गुरु साईनाथ महाराज की जय। डियर साई डिवोटीज, आई एम हियर टू रीड द चैप्टर 7। इन दिस चैप्टर वंडरफुल इनकार्नेशन बिहेवियर ऑफ साई बाबा, हिज योगिक प्रैक्टिसेस, हिज ऑल प्रिवेसिवनेस एंड मर्सी, लेपर डिवोटी सर्विस, मास्टर कापरदेस प्लेग केस, गोइंग टू पांडरपुर, वंडरफुल इनकार्नेशन। साई बाबा न्यू ऑल योगिक प्रैक्टिसेस। ही वॉज वेल वर्स्ड इन द 6 प्रोसेसेस इंक्लूडिंग धौती। धौती मीन्स स्टमक क्लीनिंग बाय अ मॉइस्टर्ड piece of linen 3 in breadth and 22 and half in length. Khanda Yoga, that is separating his limbs and joining them again, and Samadhi, etc. If you thought that he was a Hindu, he looked like a Yavan. If you thought him to be a Yavan, he looked like a pious Hindu. No one definitely knew whether he was a Hindu or a Mohammedan. He celebrated the Hindu festival of Ramanavami with all due formalities and at the same time permitted the sandal procession of the Mohammedans. He encouraged wrestling bousters in the festival. When the Gokul Ashtami came, he got the Gopal Kala ceremony duly performed, and on Eid festivals he allowed the Mohammedans to say their prayers in his masjid. Once during a Muharram festival, some Mohammedans proposed to construct a taziya and tabut in the masjid, keep it there for some days and afterwards take it in procession through village. Sai Baba allowed the keeping of the tabut for 4 days and on the 5th day got it removed from the masjid. Without the least compunction, if you say that he was a Mohammedan, his ears were pierced. If you think that he was a Hindu, he advocated the practice of circumcision. Chandorkar, who observed him closely, he was not himself circumcised. Wide article in Sai Leela and Baba Hindu Ki Yavan by B.V. Dev, page 562. If you call him Hindu, he always lived in the masjid. If you Mohammedan, he had always the Duni sacred fire there, and the following things which are contrary to Mohammedan religion, that is, grinding on the handmill, blowing of the coach and bells, oblation in the fire, bhajan giving of food and worship of Baba's feet by means of agya were allowed there. If you think that he was a Mohammedan, the best of Brahmins and Agnihotris, leaving aside their orthodox ways, fell prostrate at his feet. Those who went to make enquiries about his caste were dumbfounded and were captured by his darshan. So, none could definitely decide whether Sai Baba was a Hindu or a Mohammedan. This is no wonder, for he who completely surrenders himself to the Lord by getting rid of his egoism and body consciousness, thus becomes one with him and has nothing to do with any questions of caste or nationality. Baba saw no differences between any two castes and even between beings. He took meat and fish with fakirs but did not grumble when dogs touched the dishes with their mouths. Such a unique and wonderful incarnation was Sai Baba. On account of the merits in my past birth, I had the good fortune to sit at his feet and enjoy his blessed company. The joy and delightful I derived therefrom was incomparable. In fact, Sai Baba was pure Anand and consciousness. I cannot sufficiently describe him, his greatness, his uniqueness. He who took delight at his feet was established in his own self. Many sannyasis, sadhaks and all sorts of men aspiring for salvation came to Sai Baba. He always walked, talked and laughed with them and always uttered Allah Malik. He never liked discussion or disputation. He was always calm and controlled. Though irritable at times, always preached Vedanta, and nobody knew till the last who was Baba. Princes and poor people were treated alike by him. He knew the inmost secrets of all, and when he gave expression to them, always surprised. He was disliked honor. Such were the characteristics of Sai Baba. Though he had a human body, his deeds testified to his godhood. All people considered him as a god in Shirdi. What is the behavior of Sai Baba? Ignorant that I am, I cannot describe Baba's miracles. He got almost all the temples in Shirdi repaired. Through Tatya Patil, the temples of Shani, Ganapati, Shankar, Parvati, village, Daiti and Maruti were put in order. His charity was also remarkable. The money he used to collect as Dakshina was freely distributed, rupees 20 to some, rupees 50 to 50 to others, every day. The recipients thought that this was pure charity money, and Baba wished that it should be useful employed. People benefited immensely by having Baba's darshan. Some became hale and hearty. Wicked people were turned into good ones. Leprosy was cured in some cases. Many got their desires fulfilled without any medicine. Being put in the eyes, some blind men got back their sight and some lame ones got their limbs. Nobody could see the end of his extraordinary greatness. His fame spread far and wide and pilgrims from all sides flocked to Shirdi. Baba had his asana near the Duni and always rested here. He sat there in meditation, sometimes without a bath. He used to tie a small white turban on his head and wear a clean dhotar round his waist and a shirt on his body. This was his attire in the beginning. He first practiced medicine in the village. He examined patients and gave medicines. He was always successful and he became famous as a Hakim. A curious case may be narrated here. One devotee had his eyes quite red and swollen. No doctor was available in Shirdi. The other devotees took him to Baba. In such case, other doctors would use ointments, anjans, cow's milk and camphorated drugs, etc. Baba's remedy was quite unique. He pounded some biba, means some carpus and cadmium that is making nuts, and made two balls of them and thrust them on each eye of the patient and wrapped a cloth bandage round them. Next day, the bandage was removed and water was poured over them. The inflammation subsided and the pupils became white and clear. Though the eyes are very delicate, the biba caused no hurt but removed the disease of the eyes. Many such cases were cured. This is only one instance in this regard. Baba yogic practices. Baba knew all the process of and practices yoga. Two of them will be described here. Dauti Kriya or cleansing process. Every third day, Baba went to the well near Banyan tree at a considerable distance from the masjid, washed his mouth and had a bath. On one occasion, he was seen throwing up his intense steins, clean them inside, outside and place them on a jam tree for drying. There are people in Shirdi who have actually seen this and who have testified to this fact. Ordinary dhauti is done by a moistened piece of linen 3 inches broad, 22.5 feet long. This piece is gulped down the throat and allowed to remain in the stomach for about half an hour for being reacted there and then taken out. But Baba dhauti was quite unique and extraordinary. Kanda Yoga. In this practice, Baba extracted the limbs from his body and left them separately at different places in the masjid. Once a gentleman went to the masjid and saw the limbs of Baba lying in separate places. He was terrified. He first thought of running to the village officers and informing them of Baba being hacked to pieces and murdered. He thought that perhaps he would be held responsible as he was the first informant and knew something of the affair. So he kept silent, but next day when he went to the masjid, he was very much surprised to see Baba, hale and hearty as before. He thought that what he had seen the previous day was only a dream. Baba practiced yoga since his infancy and nobody knew or guessed the proficiency he had attained in it. He charged no fees for his cures, became renowned and famous by virtue of his merits, gave health to many a poor and suffering person. This famous doctor of doctors cared not for his interest but always worked for the good and welfare of others, himself suffering unbearable and terrible pain many a time in the process. One such instance I will relate now, which will show the all-pervasive and the most merciful character of Sai Baba. Baba's all-pervasiveness and mercy. In the year 1910, Baba was sitting near the Duni on Diwali and warming himself. He was putting firewood in the Duni, which was burning brightly. A little later, instead of pushing logs of wood, Baba pushed his arm into the Duni. His arm was scorched and burned. This was noticed by the errand boy Madhav and also by Madhav Rao Deshpande. They at once ran to Baba and Madhav Rao clasped Baba by his waist from behind and dragged him forcibly backward and asked, "Deva, why you did done this?" Then Baba came to his senses and replied, "The wife of a blacksmith at some distant place was working the bellows of a furnace. Her husband called her, forgetting that her child was on her lap. She got up hastily and child slipped into the furnace. I immediately thrust my hand into the furnace and saved the child. I do not mind my arm being burned, but I am glad that the life of the child is saved." Left devotee service. On hearing the news of Baba hand being burned from Madhav Rao Deshpande, Mr. Nana Saheb Chandorkar, accompanied by the famous doctor Paramanand of Mumbai, with his medical outfit consisting of ointments, lint and bandages, etc., rushed to Shirdi and requested Baba to allow Dr. Paramanand to examine the arm and dress the wound caused by the burn. This was refused. Ever since the burned arm was dressed by Bhagoji Shinde, a leper devotee, his treatment consisted in massaging the burnt part with ghee and then placing a leaf over it and bandaging it tightly. Mr. Nana Sahib Chandarkar solicited Baba many a time to unfasten the bandages, get the wound examined, dressed and treated by Dr. Paramanand with the object that it may heal fast. Dr. Paramanand himself made similar requests, but Baba postponed it by saying that Allah was his doctor and did not allow his arm to be examined. Dr. Paramanand's medicines were not exposed to the air of Shirdi and they remained intact. But he had the good fortune of getting a darshan of Baba. Bhagoji was allowed to treat the hand daily. After some days, the arm healed and all were happy. Still, we do not know whether any trace of pain was left or not. Every morning, Bhagoji went through his program of untying the bandages, massaging the arm with ghee and tightly bandaging it again. This went on till Sai Baba's Samadhi. Sai Baba's perfect Siddha. As he was did not really want this treatment, but out of love for his devotee, he allowed the upasana service of Bhagoji to go on uninterrupted all. Along when Baba started for Lindi, Bhagoji held an umbrella over him and accompanied him. Every morning when Baba sat near the post close to the Duni, Bhagoji was present and started his service. Bhagoji was a sinner in his past birth. He was suffering from leprosy. His fingers had shrunk. His body was full of pus and smelling badly. Though outwardly he seemed so unfortunate, he was really very lucky and happy, for he was the premier servant of Baba and got the benefit of his company. Master Kabarthi's plague case. I shall now relate another key instance of Baba's wonderful Leela. Mr. Kabarthi, the wife of Mr. Dada Sahib Kabarthi of Amravati, was staying in Shirdi with her young son for some days. One day, the son got his high fever, which further developed into bubonic plague. The mother was frightened and felt most uneasy. She thought of leaving the place for Amravati and went near Baba in the evening. When he was coming near the Vada in his evening rounds for asking his permission, she informed him in a trembling tone that her dear young son was down with plague. Baba spoke kindly and softly to her, saying that the sky is beset with clouds, but they will melt and pass off and everything will be smooth and clear. So, saying, he lifted up his kafni up to the waist and showed to all present four fully developed bubus as big as eggs and added, "See how I have a suffer for my devotees. Their difficulties are mine. Seeing this unique and extraordinary deed, the people were convinced as to how the saints suffer pains for their devotees. The hearts of the saints is softer than wax. It is soft in, out as a butter. They love their devotees without any idea of gain and regard them as their true relatives." Going to Pandharpur. I shall now close the chapter after relating a story illustrating how Sai Baba loved his devotees and anticipated their wishes and movements. Mr. Nana Sahib Chandarkar, who was a great devotee of Baba, was Mamaltar and Nandarbhar in Khandesh. He got an order to transfer to Pandharpur. His devotion to Sai Baba borne fruit. As he got an order to go and stay in Pandharpur, which is regarded as the Bhuvaikuntha, heaven on the earth, Nana Sahib had to take immediate charge. So he left for the place without even writing or informing anybody at Shirdi. He wanted to give a surprise visit at Shirdi, his Pandharpur, see and salute his Vithoba and then proceed further. Nobody knew of Nana Sahib's departure of Shirdi, but Sai Baba knew all about this, as his eyes were everywhere. As soon as Nana Sahib approached Nimgaon, a few miles from Shirdi, there was a stir in the masjid at Shirdi. Baba was sitting and talking with Mahalsapati, Appa Shinde and Kashiram. When he at once, "Let us all four do bhajan. The doors of Pandri are open. Let us sing merrily." Then they began to sing in chorus. The bhava of the song being, "I have to go to Pandharpur and I have to stay on there, for it is the house of my Lord." Baba sang and devotees followed him. After a short while, Nana Sahib came there with his family, prostrated before Baba and requested to him to accompany them to Pandharpur and stay with him. This solicitation was not necessary, as the devotees told Nana Sahib that Baba was already in the mood of going to Pandharpur and staying there. Hearing this, Nana Sahib was moved and fell at Baba's feet. Then after getting Baba's permission, Udi and blessings, Nana Sahib left for Pandharpur. There is no end to Baba's stories, but let me now stop here, reserving for the next chapter other topics such as importance of human life, Baba's living on alms, Bhajabai service and other stories. Bow to Shirdi Sai. Bow to Shri Sai. Peace be to all. Om Shri Sai Nadaya Namaha. Om Namo Shri Sai Nadaya Namaha. Om Shri Sadguru Sai Nad Maharaj Ki Jai. Om Shri Sai Nadaya Namaha. Om.